Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Without America's labor unions, we wouldn't have many of the protections and benefits that we have today. Every American worker benefits from the hard-fought battles of our labor unions, but they're becoming extinct under our watch. Joining me now to talk about how we can revive labor unions are attorneys Joe Cotchett and Mike Burg. Joe, the National Labor Relations Act was a great idea. Unfortunately, we have a labor board that's not doing a lot for American workers nowadays. What's the quick history? Why did we have the board to begin with, and where do you see it heading for the American worker right now?
Well, the board coming out of the Depression was to give lift all boats, that is to say, allow people to organize against partnerships, corporations, and everything else. And unfortunately, the board is stymied because they can't get sufficient people on the board that understand that principle. Republicans in the Senate block anything to appoint to the NLRB.
So we had Michael Burg, we had Obama trying to make appointments. It just died. Nothing really occurred. And now we have a board really that, if you take a look at the history, it's a little disturbing. I mean, the last big decision that came out of the board was the Dana Corporation decision. And with that decision, they actually took rights away from people's right to be able to organize a labor union. So this is a board that FDR thought was critical to moving the American middle class ahead and creating a middle class in America that was sustainable. Now we have a board that seems dead in the water. What's your take on it?
Well, my take is that people don't really understand how important unions are to this country. First of all, they put more money in the pockets of the workers. The workers get better wages, they get health insurance, they get pensions, and then they put that money back into the economy. The right-wing Republicans are doing everything they can to try to keep the unions from being able to be viable, and they block everything Obama's trying to do.
Joe, in the last, I guess during the Bush years, it was easy for me to say it's all Republicans' fault, it's all the Republicans' fault. Now I wonder, does this president have the stomach for a fight? I mean, listen, a president can draw the line in the sand. A president can go office to office and say, you know what, you can vote against me on this, but let me tell you how you're going to suffer if you do that. Do you feel like we're getting enough of that from this president where it comes to issues like the labor board taking no action in recent history to protect the worker?
The answer is no, and it's really very simple. It's not the Obama administration that is timid or sitting on the sidelines on this. It's our U.S. Senate. The U.S. Senate right now is a disgrace in not standing up for unions and or working people. That's the real problem. The Senate is passing legislation and or blocking appointments that would otherwise help the middle class, help unions. We all understand just what Michael said. The better unionization we have, the better it is for a middle-class America. Now, here's the problem. The fact of the matter is that some unions have gone overboard on their pensions, and the public now is being disheartened by what they're seeing specifically in public pensions. So you've got some governors around the United States that are dealing with that, and we've got to put the monkey back on the Senate to pass laws that are fair to unions. You know what's happening to union membership. It's plummeting like a rock. And the reason for that is we now have, what is it, 23, 26 states that are right-to-work states, and those state legislatures are dominated by Wall Street and corporate America. Therein lies the problem.
Michael Burg, right-to-work. What a, you know, when I hear the term right-to-work, what it really means is right to work for no wages, right to work for no pension, right to work with no time off, right to work with no protection to the worker. But it started like a wildfire in the southern states, didn't it? They came to the southern states, they tried to create their own little Saipan right here in the United States in places like Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Texas, Louisiana, any place where they could go and say, look, we're going to bring you jobs, but they weren't jobs that were meant to pay a quality of life for a middle class, was it?
No, absolutely. And what's going on when you say what they want to do is they want to turn part of this country into Southeast Asia. We have corporations that are still making shoes in Southeast Asia, and they're doing it with child labor. The reason this act was passed was to stop child labor. to stop the corporations from basically using the worker and using the worker with long hours, with no time off, with low pay. And the intent was to protect the worker by letting him to organize. And right now we have this big push by Wall Street and large corporations to try to get away with that, to make their own SIPAY right here in the United States.
Joe, you had the National Labor Relations Act that also did something else. It created an American middle class, where we didn't have one. We had a disparity in income, a disparity in wealth in the country that we're, for the first time, we're seeing it repeated, maybe even worse today than it was when they enacted the National Labor Relations Act. But it was to create a middle class. Did it work?
Well, it worked at the time, but Mike is absolutely right. We're in full-scale retreat. When is the last time you bought a television made in America? 75% of all electronic goods are made offshore, of which the NLRB has no control. 80% of many of our products, major products, are made offshore. So what Mike was pointing out is that you have cheap labor in countries like Brazil, China, India, doing work that American workers were doing. So it's not only the lack of the ability to organize workers here, it is all the money that's being shipped offshore, the work that's being shipped offshore to get out from under unionism.
And Joe, wasn't that part of what the National Labor Relations Act was supposed to do? Mike, let me go to you. We had this notion that we were going to have an act that was going to empower labor. Because what had happened in 1819, 1837, 1857, 1873, I mean, decade after decade, you had a fiscal disasters. You had panics that were taking place. And the people that looked at this act said, in order to avoid these panics, in order to create some stability in our economy, we have to have a middle class, and we can only do that by empowering labor. Now the truth is, we with Taft-Hartley, we started reversing on that. Landrum-Griffith, we started reversing on that. It's not getting any better. Aren't we returning to where we started?
We are, and it's a charade. I think Joe makes a great point. What's going on is the labor relations is supposed to be helping the worker. What's going on is they're actually helping the giant corporations, many of which are making obscene profits by using cheap labor overseas. What we need to do is we need to have them go back and really mandate for our workers here in the United States and make sure that the corporations are not allowed to be renegades and go over there and use that cheap labor. Instead, what we're doing is we're trying to allow them to create cheap labor here in right-to-work states, which is not good for the middle class or the economy.
Joe, one other thing it does, if you follow this story, it's not just we're losing a middle class. It's not just that right to work. In a right to work state, I think the average worker makes about $5,000 to $6,000 less than a non-right to work state. But what's happening, isn't it causing a wealth shift? The shift is taking place to the 1% even more. And as that wealth shift takes place, doesn't political shift take place as well? In other words, if that 1% is controlling all the politics, it's a vicious cycle. It never gets better for the worker, does it?
Well, it doesn't, and you put your finger right on it. As all you have to do is look at the Great Recession of 2007 and see how income or the large profits and or big incomes have all consolidated in that upper 1%, 2%, 3%. And of course, with the Supreme Court case of Citizens United, that group of people, 1%, can control the political body. Now, let's go back, though, to shipping jobs offshore. It's not only shipping jobs offshore. Do you know if you stood down on the border in San Diego and looked over the border into Mexico, you would see plant after plant after plant manufacturing goods, which are then brought into the United States, not manufactured here, and profit centers made offshore. So you take a company like Apple. Apple has billions and billions of dollars offshore. I could go through company after company after company. General Electric paid no taxes last year. And therein lies the problem. So it's not just the downplay or the putting unions away. It is the inability of our current structure to deal with Wall Street and their shenanigans.
Because
middle class is getting killed.
One reason is it because it shifts the money away from middle class. They don't have political power. And I think your statement makes that very clear. Michael, we have some fundamentals in this country, something as fundamental as freedom of speech, freedom of press. We used to have a fundamental of freedom to organize, and that freedom to organize was so important that after the Second World War, we helped them write it into their constitution in Japan. We said you must have this right for a worker to be able to organize and create a union because it increases their ability to confront the employer. Employer-employee relationship's important. We said the same thing in Germany. We helped write that into their constitution. Why is it we're able to do that for other countries, but right now in America, we're at such a serious decline?
Because the Apples and the large corporations are controlling politics, they're controlling what's going on, and what they're doing is creating a big charade for the American people. They come in and say, well, the labor's too high here, but when you look at their obscene profits that they're making, it's not that the labor's too high, it's that they just don't, they want to make so much money that they're not willing to back and support the good American worker who's going to build that product better, who's going to come to work every day, who has pride in America. And this is what we need to change. People have to stand up and they have to speak out and say, we're not going to tolerate it anymore. U.S. Senate, Congress, President, we need to have a voice. We have the right to organize, and we need to have those jobs here in America.
Joe, in about a minute, tell me, has the American worker just become lazy to the point to where we can't count on the American worker, or has it become a situation to where we've been led to believe that they're lazy and therefore they shouldn't be able to organize and they shouldn't be able to move ahead?
That's the word that Wall Street puts out. They're not only not lazy, middle-class America is now working two jobs to maintain a household. Many households are working three jobs to maintain the level of income that they had in the past. So it's laziness has nothing to do with it. Mike put his finger on it. There's only one word to summarize this entire discussion, and that's greed. It's all about large profits coming off of Wall Street. I keep going back to Wall Street, and I keep mentioning them, because that's the dominating street. It is not Main Street.
It is Wall Street
that's dominating this country right now through political contributions. End of story.
Joe Cotchett, Mike Burg, thanks for joining me. We'll continue this conversation week after week. It's an important one.